Throughout these tutorials, we've talked about favorable interactions. Favorable interactions or processes are those that occur spontaneously or naturally. For example, two opposite magnets spontaneously come together. Rocks spontaneously roll downhill, and ignited wood spontaneously burns in the presence of oxygen. This doesn't mean that these processes happen quickly. It only means that they would happen if they could. All spontaneous processes release energy. We'll spend this tutorial talking about thermodynamics, which is the study of energy. With the help of thermodynamics, we can quantify these spontaneous processes. In particular, thermodynamics can help us understand protein folding. Energy comes in many forms, which can be categorized into either kinetic energy or potential energy. Kinetic energy is the energy of motion, which includes thermal energy. Potential energy is stored energy, which includes chemical potential energy, gravitational potential energy, and electrical potential energy. All energy is defined as the ability to do work. A high-energy person might be lifting, kinetic, or able to lift, potential, a lot of weight, and a high-energy molecule might be able to initiate a reaction. For our purposes, there are two important laws about energy. The first is that energy can neither be created nor destroyed. Instead, energy is converted between forms. For example, if you're standing on a cliff 20 feet above a lake, you have high gravitational potential energy. Once you jump off, that potential energy is converted into kinetic energy. The second law is that favorable processes, also called spontaneous processes, that occur naturally always proceed toward lower overall energy. By the time you're in the lake, you have lower overall energy. You no longer have that gravitational potential energy, and you're no longer moving, so you don't have kinetic energy. The energy you lost hasn't been destroyed. It dissipated into the air and water as heat. You spontaneously move from the top of the cliff to the bottom at the lake, but not in the other direction. The only way to get back up to the top is to harness energy from another source, such as using the energy from food you ate that morning to climb back up to the top. Think about a piece of wood. Wood is made of lots of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen atoms covalently bonded together, and these covalent bonds have chemical potential energy. When wood burns, those bonds are broken, which releases energy and forms carbon dioxide and water vapor. The bonds in these molecules are also covalent, but they have lower chemical potential energy. This spontaneous reaction released energy into the environment, mostly in the form of heat. That energy wasn't destroyed, it was released as heat that is dispersed into the surrounding environment. The chemical potential energy of wood was used to do work, to form different bonds and to create thermal energy, which is the movement of atoms and molecules. The reverse process, forming wood from carbon dioxide and water, is not a spontaneous reaction because it requires forming molecules with higher energy. The measure of a molecule's energy that can be harnessed to do work is Gibbs free energy, abbreviated G. A molecule with high usable energy has a high G, and a molecule with low usable energy has a low G. It's hard to determine the free energy of a molecule, but it's much easier to determine the change in free energy when one molecule is transformed into another. So we'll spend most of our time talking about a change in Gibbs free energy, or delta G. Delta is a Greek letter, and capital delta means change. Delta G is defined as the free energy of the final state, GF, minus the free energy of the initial state, GI. If a process goes from high free energy initially to low free energy in the final state, then delta G is negative and the process is spontaneous. It released energy. If the process goes from low free energy initially to high free energy, then delta G is positive, which is not spontaneous. Gibbs free energy takes into account three major factors: enthalpy, entropy, and temperature. The first is enthalpy, which is a measure of total energy, including chemical potential energy, as well as energy that can't be harnessed to do work. The second is entropy, which is a measure of the number of ways to arrange something, often referred to as disorder. Entropy is a kind of energy that cannot be harnessed to do work, so it's subtracted from enthalpy to determine free energy. Finally, there's temperature, which affects a molecule's kinetic energy. Intuitively, it makes sense that each of these factors is included in spontaneity. Think again about wood burning to form carbon dioxide and water vapor. The chemical potential energy in wood is higher than in carbon dioxide and water vapor, so enthalpy decreases in this reaction. This is analogous to a rock rolling down a hill, moving toward lower potential energy. A decrease in enthalpy contributes to the spontaneity of a process. Additionally, there are more ways to arrange gas molecules than to arrange molecules of wood. Wood is regularly arranged and neatly located together in one place, while gases disperse randomly through the air. In other words, the molecules of wood are ordered, while gas molecules are disordered. So entropy increases as wood is burned to create carbon dioxide and water vapor. An increase in entropy contributes to the spontaneity of a process. It would be really unlikely for gases to come back together in the perfect arrangement to reform wood, so that reverse process would certainly not be spontaneous. The amount that entropy plays a role in spontaneity depends on temperature. If a process occurs at high temperature, then entropy plays a larger role in determining spontaneity. Temperature at a molecular level is the kinetic energy of molecules. The faster those gas molecules are moving around, the less likely it is that they'll interact in the correct orientation to reform wood. So we can write delta G as equal to delta H minus T delta S, the change in enthalpy minus the temperature times the change in entropy. The most conceptually obvious example of a spontaneous reaction, one with a negative delta G, is one that has both a negative delta H and a positive delta S. That is, one that forms molecules with lower total energy and with more disorder. But as long as delta G is negative, a process can be spontaneous with any combination of delta H and delta S. Let's think about how this applies to protein folding. We've seen the various levels of a protein's structure, from the sequence of amino acids to the regular alpha helices and beta sheets formed by hydrogen bonds in the backbone, to the interactions between side chains that form the overall three-dimensional shape. Think about an unfolded polypeptide that only has a primary structure. The enthalpy of this polypeptide is high because it lacks many favorable interactions. Creating bonds and allowing favorable interactions to form lowers enthalpy. In the unfolded polypeptide, hydrophobic amino acids may be exposed to the cytoplasm, or ionic bonds may not be formed, or maybe cysteine amino acids haven't formed disulfide bonds. But the entropy of this polypeptide is high because it can bend and move randomly. This freedom to move gives it many possible ways to be arranged and thus high entropy. As the protein folds, its enthalpy decreases, but its entropy also decreases. Remember, low enthalpy and high entropy is favorable. So the change in enthalpy going from the unfolded state to the folded state is negative, which contributes to the spontaneity of the process. But the change in entropy is also negative, which works against the spontaneity. At normal biological temperature, the decrease in enthalpy overcomes the decrease in entropy, so protein folding is spontaneous. I've indicated that because the temperature is fairly low, the entropy term is small, so the negative enthalpy drives the spontaneity. The process of protein folding has a negative delta G. An unfolded protein has higher free energy than a folded protein, so the process is spontaneous, releases energy, and is favorable. In fact, proteins will fold until they reach their lowest free energy state. This is why a given polypeptide chain always folds into the same shape, why hemoglobin, for example, always looks the same. It always folds into that same lowest free energy state. One way to denature or unfold a protein is to heat it up. This increase in temperature gives the entropic term more weight in determining delta G. In other words, higher temperature favors the disordered state, even if it means breaking some favorable interactions or bonds. Because an unfolded protein is more disordered, heating up a protein is one way to unfold it, breaking those ionic and polar covalent bonds.